Hey everyone, it's DR Sean. Welcome to another edition of the Women Business Leaders Show. This show is geared to bring lessons from women business leaders to women business leaders. Really, how can we do things better in business? How can we work through the environment we're in? It's not about men against women. That's one of the reasons we do this as a show. Leah Woodford, my regular co-host, will be joining us soon. I'm the R. Sean. I'm a corporate lawyer by training. And Anessa Santos, a fellow corporate lawyer, is joining us today. And we're going to be talking about microfinance, what it is, what it means, and what it can really mean to the international community. This can be a big thing for women in business, particularly women internationally. So we'll be diving into that some more. I want to encourage you folks to drop your comments below wherever you're watching. You might be picking up on R. Sean McBride Hanson's Facebook. You might be watching the Women Business Leaders YouTube channel. You might be on one of our LinkedIn feeds. Wherever you're at, go ahead and drop a comment. Let us know what you're thinking. Let us know what you're seeing, any questions you have, because we'll come back and comment and work with you. We really want to know what's going on. Seeing as we've got two lawyers on the show, I think it's appropriate to remind you we don't do investment advice. We don't do legal advice on the show. Everything here is just for your education. Consult your own advisors for those particular issues. But we really do want to give you those things that are going to give you a leg up, give you some additional ideas, and really inspire your thinking. And that's what today's show is really about, is inspiring your thinking. So let us know what you're seeing. Let us know what you're thinking. We want to hear those comments. With that, Anessa, welcome to the show. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
Hi, Leah. I haven't met you before, Leah. This is fantastic. I'm so excited that Sean has such a lovely, astute co-host. This is great.
Yes. Leah's amazing.
Did you pay her to say that, Sean?
No.
I did not, but I will make sure. Yeah. So Anessa's fantastic. I mean, she's a great lawyer. We got to know each other through the legal world and the technology side of law. And, you know, one of the fantastic things about Anessa is she's always looking to the future of the world, the future of business, and a lot of humanitarian type efforts too. Not just, hey, you know, I can help you crank out your documents and get your blockchain deal done, which she can. But it's also like, what is the broader implications of this stuff? And so let's dive in a little bit to microfinance, Anessa. Not everybody has familiarity with what this is. Why don't you just take a quick moment and break it down for maybe that regular business owner who hasn't really dove into this world?
Right. So microfinancing is a little bit different if we're talking about it in the context of the Western world versus maybe the Global South. Right. And so the Global South would be, Africa, parts of, Asia and South America as well. And it's like a new term that we're sort of using as opposed to, say, the third world or the developing world, because even in parts of the Global South, we're seeing a lot of folks that are being really launched out of poverty and into opportunity. So, developing nations or third world countries isn't really the best descriptive term to really talk about these locations. Right. But when we're talking about microfinancing in reference to what we traditionally think of as the first world or developed nations or the Western world, right, we're thinking about finance options that are lower than $10,000. When we're thinking about microfinance and what does that mean for the Global South, we're thinking of things that are maybe like under $5,000, maybe $100, $150 in areas of the world where you may only make a few dollars a day. $150 could be like 3 months worth of income for you. That's generally what microfinance means.
Yes. And so this is a big deal in these economies that you talk about, right? I mean, to really get this money to the ground. And of course, a lot of, the traditional lenders aren't as interested in it. So we have to come up with alternate ways to get it to the ground, right? And that's what does it mean to the people that are borrowing the money? I mean, what does it really do for some of these cases?
So it seems like for us, $150 is maybe a halfway decent date night. But for some people in the world, this could be an opportunity to have a viable, successful startup business. Wow. But the challenges that we are finding is how do we get the $150, or just for the sake of like easy math, why don't we just talk about it in terms of say $100? How do we get $100 into the hands of a young woman in Indonesia, for example? And this is really where we're encountering some of the issues. The only way to really do it right now is if we set up maybe a charitable organization here in the United States, a nonprofit, so they can take in the donations, have them be tax-free, and then this charitable donation is going to have some sort of a physical presence over in Indonesia, and they're going to have to actually have a bank account over there so that they can make maybe interbank transfers, currency transfers. And it's all about how are we going to get around the payment mechanisms? How do we get money from here to there? And I got to be honest with you, Sean, I was completely clueless about this world until, gosh, I want to say maybe like the last 2 years.
Yeah.
It never occurred to me that it would be so complicated. When I travel to South America, I have a special travel card for travel purposes through Bank of America, and I just sort of go all around, and there's like practically no fees. I didn't really understand that that was a position of privilege. And I'm not even trying to be politically correct here. This is literally a position of privilege. And that if you don't have access to those kind of perks with your bank account, that using a credit card or making currency conversions when you're traveling or when you're trying to get money from here to there costs money. It's a service. There's a middleman, an infrastructure, if you will, and it requires people to handle money. It requires accounting and bookkeeping. And there's all this infrastructure that's very expensive to maintain, and somebody's got to pay for it. And the people that pay for that infrastructure are the same people that are looking to convert their money or transfer their money. Yep. So when we're talking about maybe moving $100 from the United States into Indonesia, and if you're doing this via traditional payment rails, it can, like, from bank to bank, just an international bank wire, it varies depending on the bank and the transaction and the currency and the whole thing, but it can cost you about $80.
Wow.
So if you're sending $100 and it costs you $80, then the other person on the other end only ends up with $20. So right. This is not a viable solution when we think about remittances, when we think about microfinance. And so when people really want to make a difference and they want to give and they want to contribute in a meaningful way to the lives of other people elsewhere, it's a problem because the middle person, that middleman, if you will, is really taking a substantial portion of the proceeds. Now, obviously, if you're going to send over $10,000, then, and it's a flat rate fee, then, you know, the percentage ends up shifting. But the point is like, does this mean that you have to wait until you can collect like this big wad of $10,000 or $50,000 or whatever it is before you can send it over? And how long does it take to sort of accrue that kind of money? So if Joe needs to send money to his niece, Sally, right, in Indonesia because she's had an emergency accident, she needs an emergency surgery. Sorry, Sally, I can't help you because I have to wait until I can collect enough money, you know, to cover the cost of the fee. This is a big problem. Our system is not working, but we think blockchain can help.
Yes, well, let's one more thing before we get a little deeper in that is, you know, why is this a women's issue? Why is this important to women in business? Let's tie that knot.
Because statistically, women are responsible for the microeconomies of most of the global South. They're responsible for the care of the children. They're responsible for the care and the infrastructure, the social infrastructure of their communities. And we need to have a working infrastructure in place to support the development, you know, the economical development, the educational development, and the social development of women and children throughout the global South.
So, but that's the way it is here in the United States too. Women are responsible for the major purchases. We're 87%, 92% if it's healthcare related.
Yeah.
So it's nice to know that we're still making the decisions for that globally as well.
We are making those decisions globally. And so where I think we're seeing a lot of the disconnect is that traditionally the regulatory landscape has been brought about by men. And it's really interesting, right? Because when we look at it statistically, men don't make these kinds of decisions, right? For the home and for the family or maybe for the education. It's really women that drive it when we see it statistically. around the world, but yet men are the ones that are developing out the regulations that govern how all of this is supposed to work.
Yeah, they're kind of doing that here as well.
Yes, and while it's changing, boy, it's slow. And we see pushback, right? In some countries, we're seeing where women were making strides. Now maybe they're being pushed back out. And in the United States, ironically, right, women have a lot less say in the governance of their communities or of their country than maybe even in some of the Global South jurisdictions. You know, I see that the role that women play in governance in many South American nations is on a much greater percentage than we see them here in the United States.
Yeah, so I mean, it's fascinating to look at that. So, you know, let's zoom in a little bit on the humanitarian side of this, Anessa. So, you know, the goal here is to kind of spread the word, help women business leaders that might be thinking about other leaders in the world or men as well. So what is the future here? What do you foresee starting to happen or being possible with, you mentioned some blockchain solutions, some other things. What is the future of this world?
Well, it's really interesting that you asked that because I didn't know the answer a couple of weeks ago and I do today. Right? Yeah, I'm just like, wow, right, timing. And maybe a lot of other people listening actually knew the answer to this, but I didn't know the answer to this. And I've been kind of like working my way along to figure out the answer. And so I took this class, right, and I'm currently in this class, the FinTech class. It's a killer. It's like 25 hours a week on top of my full-time job. And what I am learning is that there's over 1 billion people in the world who have no government recognized identification. These people have zero access to banking or financial infrastructure. And that might not seem like a very big deal, but I've learned what an incredibly big deal that is, because if you don't have an identification, you can't enroll your kids in school. You can't get access to government services. Like say, for example, you don't have health insurance, or if you go to a hospital, you might not get any care or any attention whatsoever, or you might be imprisoned. If you're here in the United States and you don't have an identification, chances are you're gonna get picked up by ICE, right? And thrown into a detention center, and they're gonna ship you back to wherever they feel like that you might belong, regardless of what you say. And so not having an identification means you can't go to a bank and you can't open a bank account. So if you have any kind of a means to earn an income whatsoever, what are you going to do with it, right? You can't get a credit card. You might be able to get a cash card through an ATM machine that will spit you out a cash card when you put in cash. But of course, there's the cost of doing that. There's the transaction cost that the company that's operating the card, you know, the cash ATM card machine is going to take. So what are you going to do with this? Or you're going to walk around with it. You're going to stuff it in your cookie tin or your coffee can or whatever it is, right? And then in addition to the 1.1 billion people around the world who have zero government recognized identification, you have an additional 2.5 billion people that are underbanked. Underbanked. What does that look like? Well, it looks a little bit like how I just started out the conversation, which is, wow, I took it for granted that I have this nifty little travel Visa card attached to my Bank of America account so that when I travel and I use it, the cost is minimal, right? But for other people, the cost is enormous, right? So that might be an example of being underbanked or not having access to a sufficient line of capital so that you could go and purchase a vehicle to actually transport yourself back and forth to your job. So we have some major problems in society that we have got to solve for 50%. 50% of the global population, 3.5 billion people. So when we think about the stratification of the layers of our social economy, this is behemoth, right? And who's running this show? Who's caused this issue? So we have the banking and the financial infrastructure. And due to recent issuances of Know Your Customer anti-money laundering regulations, the kinds of identification that are required to open a bank account, the bar for this is even higher than it was prior to the collapse of the markets in 2007 and 2008. So it's even harder. Even if you do have a government ID, you can't get a bank account. So now that we have framed up the problem, what is our solution? Well, our solution is blockchain. And the banking and the financial institutions around the world are currently working together with fintech companies that are innovating out KYC compliant blockchain identification registries that work via multi-factor biometric authentication. So that when you talk about who is Anessa Santos, right? Well, this is my retina, this is my fingerprint, you know, maybe I'm 5 foot five and a half and I was born in this year and this is my education and these, you know, maybe these are my kids or these my parents, right? And so then you kind of pull in the social network as a potentiality for identification. And so what we're seeing is that in various jurisdictions around the world, we see governments that are working together with banking and financial institutions. And the idea is so that when we assign a blockchain-based ID for an individual, that that blockchain ID is the same ID that is sufficient for them to open a bank account. It's the same ID that's sufficient for them to get their concealed carry weapons permit here, maybe in the state of Florida. It's the same ID that my daughter is going to carry with her when I register her in Windermere High School, or I pull her out and I put her in Florida Virtual Schools Online. I have to keep re-registering my daughter over and over and over again. Every time we move, it's like the state of Florida can't remember who she is. I'm like, what is happening here? Right.
So
this is about the solution.
Talking about a lot of efficiency potentially, right? But you're talking about delivering results. So, you know, so on the microfinance side, when we connect all these dots, we potentially the blockchain world and take some of these intermediaries out of the middle. What does it mean to life on the ground in these places in the world?
What it means is that for half of the world's population, well, for 1.1 billion people, they're going to have access now to financial services. So when you do get the $100 into their hand, there's a place they can put it so they don't have to worry about being robbed in the middle of the night. I mean, this is a real issue, folks. I have represented clients in the past who are robbed on the way to Western Union because they didn't have a bank account and they have to carry around wads of money in their pocket. And so in the community, they know when they're on the way to the Western Union and they get robbed in the parking lot of Western Union. So this is a safety issue as well. So when we're talking about what does it mean on the ground? Well, it means that if you're able, first of all, if these people can have an account, right? Because you can't open a cryptocurrency account like say on a Coinbase, right? If you want to purchase Bitcoin, you have to be able to meet KYC standards that are actually even higher than the banks, right? So you have government identification requirements are maybe here. Then you have bank identification requirements are here. And then for most of the crypto companies, right, the identification requirements are even up here, right? So it's even harder. So you think, no problem, just send them Bitcoin. Well, you can't open an account necessarily and get Bitcoin, depending on what country you are and what are the regulations that are being imposed upon those crypto companies in order for you to be open an account from your local bank, right? It varies. So what it will do is it will create global standards and protocols for identification. And everybody's going to have one. All 100% of the population. And then they will have access to finance. And then you will cut out a large portion of the cost to maintaining banking infrastructure right now is going to managing these KYC standards. Yes. So all of this is going to be remediated and intermediated or disintermediated, if you will. And so now you'll be able to remit money easily, transfer money easily. And so these folks that didn't have an opportunity, right, they'll be able to make better use of the funds that get to them. More funds will get to them. As we saw a pilot program called the Building Blocks Program in Jordan, where they blockchain the identities of 100,000 Syrian refugees, and they moved payments, right, to these Syrian refugees on a blockchain, that the necessity for involving the bank and the cost of transfers in the banks was disintermediated, and they saw a savings of $150,000 a month. So more money gets into the hands of them. And then they're able to build up a financial history that establishes a credit history for them. And it just gets the wheel turning. The wheel of prosperity gets to start rolling. And right now, there's no rolling.
So what does it mean for the future? So the women business leaders that are watching, people that are tuning in, you know, what do we do to support this effort or to get this wheel turning, as you say?
Well, I'd say, you know, Oxfam is a really good organization to take a look at, to get involved with. There's a lot of microcredit and microfinancing organizations. So if you're watching right here in the United States, for example, there are a lot of charitable organizations, and you may be thinking, thinking, well, you know, I don't know, how do I know if this charitable organization is making good use of my funds, right? And so all of that information is required to be available, and you should have an opportunity to take a look at their infrastructure and of their financial reports and their financial statements and how they're building it out to see where it is that you might want to be able to invest.
Right.
But until we can sort of get some of these behind the scenes sort of going around the bank's payment infrastructures up and running, then your best bet really is to just kind of get involved with blockchain. You might even want to get involved in lobbying for blockchain friendly legislation. You might want to put pressure on your bank, because right now we're seeing that banks, at least in this country, are largely colluding. They're absolutely colluding, because you think that you might be able to just send Bitcoin from your account to somebody else's account. But if your bank gets wind of what you're doing, we're seeing here in the US, they're shutting you down. They're turning off your bank account. Right. And so we need to remind the infrastructure that they work for us, not the other way around. There are challenger banks, right, which is a big phenomenon in the United Kingdom in particular. These are banks that don't have really any brick and mortar location. They exist solely in the cloud. There are alternative banks called, you know, challenger banks, and there are other kinds of alternative banks that are providing access to banking and financial services without all of the inside infrastructure. We don't have that here in the United States. And so I'm kind of looking and waiting to see how is our local US banking infrastructure going to be broken open by the competitor banks. Do I think it'll happen? Is it possible that David could beat Goliath? Absolutely. Sears just filed for bankruptcy, right?
Right.
This is absolutely going to happen because it's an issue that they are addressing right now today. I'm in my class, I'm being forced to read all these kinds of crazy reports coming out of these financial institutions, and it's an issue that they're standing up and taking notice of.
Yep.
Because as the customer base of the banks move to those banks that are going to provide these services, then their customer base will rank in. One of the impediments to progress is legacy infrastructure. Much of our current banking language for programming is written in COBOL, and most millennials don't program in COBOL. So we're having a problem as the older generation.
I haven't seen COBOL since the 90s, really.
Yeah. It's a major problem. So we're seeing banks are starting to partner up with some of these fintech companies to sort of create a parallel infrastructure and trying to figure out how they can either integrate it or how they can migrate it, right? Because the database systems are siloed and they're not really sure how they're going to be able to make that migration happen.
Yep.
So we vote with our dollars, we vote with our feet, right? We vote with our vote, like our actual literal vote. We lobby, and we've got to get really creative as to how it is if you're interested in supporting microfinance, right? We've got to get creative as to how can we move money today from here to there and still actually, and not have it all be eaten up by these transaction costs.
Right. Yeah. So, Anessa, you're a wealth of information. I know that, you know, you're passionate about this. You care about the community. I know you talk about these issues from time to time. I know you have a great LinkedIn page. How do people check you out and see what you're up to out there in the world?
Yeah, you can look me up on LinkedIn. My handle is Anessa Ellen Santos. My contact information is available there. And you can also check me out on my website at intellilaw.io.
Fantastic. Anessa, thanks for making some time to join us today and to help people think bigger about the impact of women globally. I think it's a really important topic, and I really appreciate it. Audience members, pat yourself on the back for thinking about some weighty issues and really trying to be part of the future. We really appreciate you doing that. I want to remind you, you can check out our past episodes at the Women Business Leaders YouTube channel. You can also find Leah and me on LinkedIn. Hope you subscribe to the YouTube channel, click the bell, and then join us for some upcoming episodes. We're looking forward to talking to you all again soon. Thanks for joining us today.
Bye-bye.
That was fantastic.